Hello, and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production of the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Allen Blakey, your host. The purpose of this series is to talk about how families act and interact, the challenges and issues they face, and to hear useful ideas about managing family relationships. And when we talk about families, we don't mean just nuclear families, though that is the starting point. Over the course of the series, we're looking at many types of relationships, workplace, community, and others, where family-type dynamics come into play. My guest for this segment is Douglas Murphy, a family therapist in private practice who directs a nonprofit agency in Baltimore County, Maryland. Doug has a degree in communication theory and did postgraduate training at the Bowen Center. He joined the Bowen Center faculty in 1992, and he was named director of the clinic in 2009. His primary clinical interest is family conflict and violence. Our topic today is the family system's view of extramarital affairs. Extramarital affairs occur in a percentage of marriages. Sometimes they are consummated, and sometimes they are only fantasized. Either way, they often disrupt the marital relationship. Viewing them from a broader perspective can raise issues that, if understood and addressed, can help the participants achieve a greater degree of emotional maturity in dealing with the marital relationship. Welcome, Doug.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Well, if Bowen family theory views families as systems, an extramarital affair certainly seems like a breakdown of a system.
A breakdown might be a little harsh. I think it has, another way of thinking about it is a corrective action for a breakdown, that the family is beginning to be unbalanced, to totter, and that in some respects the affair is an effort, although a rather poor choice, an effort to stabilize a destabilizing relationship.
Oh, not so it may not be the problem itself, but a symptom of a problem.
That is correct.
I think that it's probably a challenging concept for a lot of people.
It probably is, because of certainly the emotionality that comes out of the problem of an affair outside of a marriage. I think it's a difficult idea to get a grasp on, but with a certain amount of inspection and objectivity, one can see that there were problems before the affair began, and that the affair is an attempt in a very sort of backward way to stabilize the marital relationship, to give it a third leg or a third angle. Unfortunately, that doesn't always help the marital relationship. In fact, in many cases, it leads to the dissolution of the marital relationship.
Maybe we should digress here just momentarily and talk about a triangle, because that's an important concept in Bowen theory, right?
It is. The triangle concept, and it goes it's much more complex than this, but this is a beginning understanding of it, is that any two-person relationship, a marital relationship as an example, is inherently unstable over time. A two-person relationship will, in fact, begin to experience, after a specific period of time, a degree of anxiety that can't be contained within the relationship itself. There is a discomfort between the two marital partners. And as one effort to deal with that discomfort, usually after what is often called an emotional separation or divorce, sort of a distancing in the relationship to deal with the discomfort, one partner becomes more susceptible, more prone to reach out to another person, a third person, either in fantasy, which I think is important to keep in mind, or in actuality, to receive some sort of support in that three-person relationship.
But you're saying every one-on-one relationship is inherently unstable?
Every two-person relationship is inherently unstable and requires a third.
But some marriages seem to go on and on.
not all marriages obviously utilize a extramarital affair. There are other triangles within reach of any two-person relationship.
So most couples will, at some point or at various points in the relationship, need a third leg on the stool to keep themselves stable?
The question about need sounds a little too intentional. It happens. It's an automatic response to the inherent instability of a two-person relationship. Usually, in a nuclear family, that's a child. Having children provides more flexibility in the marital relationship. Or it can be any other third party. It can be a work system, like someone who is over-functioning at work, not functioning very well at home. It can be any set of relationships, friendships, children, so forth and so on.
Okay, interesting. So something happens in an extramarital affair that drives one of the spouses,
makes one person more vulnerable to acting out in that respect. Certainly, the distance achieved in the two-person relationship, sort of the emotional divorce, usually affects one person more than the other. Feeling more cut off from the marriage, more distanced from the marriage, more in need of some sort of intimate relationship, and that is the vulnerable person is the one who will eventually reach out to a third party, either emotionally or both physically and emotionally.
So are most couples made up of one stronger than the other, one needing more space, one needing less space, one more emotional, one less emotional?
I wouldn't characterize it as stronger or weaker. I would say more vulnerable, which is really the vulnerability is really part and parcel of the relationship itself. It's not inherent in the individual necessarily. But when the marital relationship starts having those kinds of difficulties, starts having some emotional distance, a lack of interaction between the two parties, one of those persons will be more vulnerable to reach out to a third party. And again, that's not always an extramarital relationship. It can be a number of different relationships. You've heard people complain about, well, I'm assuming you've heard people complain about friendship systems being too important to their spouses, work relationships being too important.
Right.
Same kind of phenomena without the damning effect that a marital, extramarital affair can have.
And I know in Bowen thinking, we try to avoid assigning blame to anyone, right? I mean, we are products of our genes and environment, and we tend to pass those along. So the vulnerable person, can we talk more about what makes a person vulnerable? Without wanting to, you know, blame the person for anything.
The thing that makes the person vulnerable, and we would have to, there's a much broader perspective that would take perhaps way too long for anybody to explain. The vulnerability truly comes out of the distance that occurs in the marriage, the inability of both parties to be more present and accounted for in the marriage. So that the emotional separation or emotional divorce that occurs leaves both parties vulnerable, but the most vulnerable one is the one who can, in fact, get in trouble with an affair.
But in some sense, isn't it true that in Bowen thinking, being able to stand back and recognize or feel secure in emotional distance is a sign of maturity or differentiation?
Well, it certainly is a sign that one can read unpleasant stimuli and not respond to it or act upon it. And that is an important concept in Bowen theory. It's the idea that one can tolerate, or the tolerance for, discomfort or anxiety and be able to redirect it or address it in another fashion rather than acting it out. So yes, there is that capability that people can develop or have. Either way, it certainly prevents people from moving in the wrong direction as far as the relationship is concerned.
And they may be very comfortable with space, distance, emotional.
I wouldn't necessarily say that they're comfortable. I would say they can manage themselves with it under duress. I would think that over time, a person who was able to do that could, in fact, begin to address the emotional distance in the relationship, begin to move towards the other person, or begin to be more of a person in that relationship. It's not, you know, a lifetime. I wouldn't suggest this is a good outcome, a lifetime of being sort of emotionally isolated and being able to tolerate it. I mean, I think there probably are marriages like that, no doubt about it, but I don't think that that's necessarily the best path to take.
Okay. Well, let's go back to the idea that any two-person relationship has its certain instability.
Is inherently unstable.
It's not a matter of time.
Spoken from Murray Bowen. That is a primary idea.
But you're...
I'm representing it. Yes.
An advocate or
I'm
a
representing
practitioner
it.
Of
right,
Bowen.
Right.
So it doesn't mean every 10 years it's unstable. It means inherently on a continuing basis.
Inherently on a continuing basis. But the intensity of that instability comes about from lots and lots of different factors. If in fact, you know, you have a two-person relationship that experiences more stress or more anxiety, that makes it even more inherently unstable. It's just, there's just not enough play in the relationship itself. And if the two partners are in fact emotionally distant from each other, they are not accessible to each other to sort of supply the support that's necessary.
And is there something that causes a person to look for another love interest outside the marriage, as opposed to spending all their time with their rock collection or going to
or
to
drinking
see the
heavily
dance,
or what?
Or drinking heavily.
I don't think that there's anything that has ever really been identified that predicts the pathway that anxiety will drive someone towards, but it's certain relationships are, by and large, the most stabilizing of forces that people tend to move towards.
And the most stabilizing?
The most stabilizing third angle in that two-person relationship.
Is?
A relationship. Another relationship. Other relationships.
A friendship.
It could be.
Or a child.
Could be a child. Could be a family member. Could be a therapist. Happens a great deal of the time.
That's a good time to go see a therapist if one feels the urge to cheat coming on.
Well, I think people who are dissatisfied with their marriages, even without that subject coming into their minds, often seek therapy as a third angle to stabilize the marriage. Therapists are good third angles most of the time. They can supply a certain amount of anxiety calming effect on the marriage.
Sounds like they're lightning rods.
They are.
The tension gets focused into that.
And unfortunately, so are the extramarital affairs. They tend to be pretty unstable themselves once they've sort of stabilized one situation. They tend to start getting rocky themselves. Same problems.
Okay. Because then they're an inherently unstable
Correct.
Couple.
Correct.
Okay. And so I guess we can't really generalize about extramaritals and affairs and say they're an attempt to run away from something. That's not, perhaps doesn't adequately define a situation.
I mean, you know,
although some people feel that.
You can take a look at this from so many different perspectives. Certainly there is the whole moral perspective. Certainly there is the whole Bowen perspective, and you can certainly say that somebody is running away from a difficult marriage into another relationship. I mean, again, Bowen theory offers a way of thinking about it where there's in fact some potential flexibility for correcting the problem, for changing the situation. The running away thing, I think, easily the spouse who is being is the one who's being left behind would certainly couch it in the other terms of blame, running away from, you know, being immoral, so forth and so on.
Can't face
the reality.
Things that we've created and,
right.
and has changed.
And I think it's disingenuous to think about extramarital relationships as being unusual or outside of the ordinary. My suspicion is, and it's a suspicion, I haven't done any research or surveys on this, but my suspicion is a fairly sizable proportion of marriages experience this, sometimes certainly without the other partner ever being aware of the fact, and other times the other partner being aware and it being devastating, or not being devastating at all, that somehow it gets corrected in the marriage. But I don't think it's so unusual for this to occur. I would say at least, you know, off the top of my head, a third of the marriages.
Really?
Yes,
a third?
At least.
Have an extramarital.
We'll have one incidence of it. And then those that happen in people's fantasies are probably even greater.
Even greater, like lusting in our hearts.
Yes.
Even presidents do that.
I understand they have had that lust at times. But, you know, that, again, that is the fantasy part of it. Certainly, Dr. Bowen used to say, or said at one time, that more people have extramarital affairs in their heads than in the bed. So people think about it under duress, under emotional distance from their spouses. They fantasize about it. They see people and think of them as potential partners, but they don't act on it. They have a certain constraint that keeps them from doing that.
And so Bowen theory would say this, it's not a physical thing. It's not, oh, can't perform, you know, the frequency is wrong, I need somebody more compatible. And or you would say, Bowen would say, it's rather more an emotional, it's more a function of the whole emotional being in the relationship.
And it is a function of the entire emotional system. It is the entire emotional system that's having the affair. That's why a family affair is a way of thinking about it, rather than, you know, this guy is having this affair with this person and he's married to this person. It talks about, or it views that as a disturbance in the relationship system. So everybody's involved. Not if you're looking for blame, of course, the offender is going to be the easiest target, but everybody plays their part in it. The two partners in the marital relationship play their part in the emotional distance. It may not be satisfactory for either one of them, but they both play their part in that and fail to address it, or fail to find a way to address it.
The one who has the affair is a risk taker, is risking a lot potentially, is...
They are, I don't know if I would call it, because there's a whole piece of psychology that talks about risk-taking behaviors and that kind of thing. I'm not quite sure I would put everybody in that category. I would simply say that the person who acts on it is the person who is most uncomfortable at that moment and is compelled automatically, practically automatically, in performing, in taking that opportunity of reaching out for that kind of solace.
And how could, back to the fantasy idea, it seems as though, since we assume many do lust in their hearts or
Well, we have an we have an industry that completely plays its part in this. It's called the pornography industry, I believe.
Right.
It's purely fantasy. It's a billion-dollar business on the internet, I'm assuming. And certainly that is lusting in your heart and on your web browser.
Right.
And it is, in fact...
Advertisements on TV move in that direction.
Right.
Certainly in talking up, in playing up sex.
Right, and it certainly for, you know, a percentage of people becomes a real problem. For other people, it's only an occasional thing. But it, in fact, is the exact same effort to find a way to deal with the discomfort in the original relationship.
Right.
And not all people who use pornography are married. There are certainly single people who do that as well.
Are there other, I think everyone kind of can understand how a physical relationship can intrude upon a marriage. How can fantasy relationships intrude? Are you talking about being addicted to porn? Or are there other ways that could be a problem?
There certainly is a growing industry in my field of dealing with the pornography addiction. I don't know if I necessarily, the addiction model is a little too concrete for me, but I certainly have seen people whose use of pornography disrupts their marriage. And the marriage has, it's almost the exact same kind of phenomena. The partner who is upset about that tends to react as if it's the same process. So it plays the same part in some situations. In other situations, I'm assuming I don't see them because it's not as intense or as disturbing.
Well, let's talk about whether there are signs or steps that one could take if one is in a situation, in a relationship, and are there ways to anticipate or prevent the occurrence of all relationships are inherently unstable.
All two-person
relationships are inherently
have
unstable.
Have more children, no.
Maybe that's an example of how could, or is it possible to give general advice, recognizing these are always specific situations, individual situations. Are there ways to advise folks what to look out for, what you might do here and there to recognize, anticipate, prevent?
Well, I would be addressing that primarily to the vulnerable person. I think putting the other person on high alert or total micromanaging would probably drive the other person into an affair if the anxiety got to such a point.
Okay.
So I certainly would think that one of the things that a person could do who found themselves vulnerable would be to watch as those ideas arise, as those impulses arise, and begin to consider it as an indicator that something needs to be addressed in them and in the marital relationship. So it's really, it's a very arduous thing to do, I think, and a very difficult thing to do, but it's to turn and face the marital relationship and begin to address the difficulties there, rather than reacting to the difficulties and being propelled into another relationship.
Okay. I guess the risk maybe one might feel in being the one who raises the issue is, am I creating a situation that may not, am I making a problem out of nothing? You know, am I imagining that my vulnerable spouse is starting to wander in mind and heart?
Well, I think there's certain percentage of partners who are ever watchful and highly suspicious of their spouse's behavior, and I think there's that's a real indication of the instability of the relationship, whether or not it's going on or not.
That in itself, if someone is watching too carefully.
If you're beginning to check the phone records of your spouse's cell phone, you're deeply involved with a process that, even if it's accurate, you are playing your part on the other side of that as being the partner who is anxious enough to address the instability of the relationship.
Would you recommend that spouses not check phone records or hire detectives, but rather try to find other ways to confront what may be going on?
Again, it certainly has to do with, I could make recommendations until I'm no longer able, but my sense of it is that in itself is an indicator that instead of that process, that one begins to address the problems in the marriage.
Yeah. And you know, I know I'm putting you on the spot here. I'm trying to give us cut and dry advice so we could write it all down.
And do it.
Like a recipe.
They won't
and
do it anyway.
It doesn't work that way.
No, it does not. But that would certainly be an indicator on the other person's side, is their suspicions, their paranoia, their, you know, whatever, is in fact what is going on in their in themselves that should be an indicator that they need to begin to address the problem.
So don't think of it as it's his or her doing. Think of it in terms of what's going on in our relationship.
Between the two
of
you.
How can we work together?
Yes.
Seek a good third, a helpful third.
Find a useful third party.
Not a destructive
third. Minister, certainly, a priest. Those, they have been certainly providing that kind of counseling forever. Certainly a therapist, a counselor, somebody who can remain relatively neutral to the process and help both parties begin to address their difficulties in the relationship.
That's where counselors really do have a valuable role to play, because they're trained to look at these things in a calm, reflective way, we hope, and help sort through the emotions and the thoughts and the thought process. Friends, I mean, we hear about just talk it out, tell somebody, vocalize your concerns. But again, I guess it depends on who you're doing that with.
I think that's a little riskier, and certainly family members a little riskier, because basically what people are doing in that is trying to find a coalition with a third party against the other. Not all the time. Sometimes friends can be neutral, sometimes family members can be neutral, but that. The issue itself is so inflammatory, so emotionally reactive for most people, I would say for most of us, that the mere indication that that may be occurring probably will sort of obliterate anybody's attempt at being neutral in it, unless people are prepared to do that. And in some respects, the professions and the ministry have been prepared to at least think about it in a little bit more objective fashion. Instead of taking sides, instead of jumping to conclusions. Certainly lawyers would not be a good people to consult with, because they're adversarial.
In this situation,
they're adversarial.
I believe, yes. Right. You want somebody who's
a little, doesn't have a vested interest, but is interested in remaining objective and neutral.
Who will try to see both sides. Will see both sides, and then each member of the couple, hopefully, too.
Hopefully.
Thank you, Doug. Very interesting. Thanks for sharing these insights. If you would like more information on our topic or would like to learn more about the services offered at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Allen Blakey, and your family does matter.